if I can just start off with a question in light of those songs that we just sang. You know, we're singing about his faithfulness. He does not fail. He cannot fail. He will not fail. So let me start off by asking this question right out of the gate. Have you ever sacrificed anything of yourself? Your time, your energy, your talents, money. Have you ever sacrificed anything to the point that it hurt? To the point that it was uncomfortable? To the point that perhaps you felt it, you hesitated, you weren't sure if you were going to do it? Have you ever sacrificed anything of yourself for Jesus to the point that it hurt? Could be, you know, you hadn't had a break in days. You've been working for 3 weeks straight and someone calls up out of the blue needing you to help unload their house, pack up a U-Haul. It's a Saturday, the only Saturday you have free for the next 3 weeks. Have you ever sacrificed to the point that it hurt? Paid some significant bill for someone and you know it was going to stress you, but it hurt a little bit. Have you ever sacrificed anything of yourself for Jesus to the point that it was uncomfortable, that you're uncertain that it hurt? And then let me ask this follow-up question. Do you do that on a regular basis? Do you do that on a regular basis? See, we're coming to the end of our Nehemiah study here in just a couple more weeks, and we are coming to a point where the rubber is hitting the road. There's been amazing things that have happened in 52 days. A wall is rebuilt. The people are coming back into the city of Jerusalem. They're starting to revive their worship culture and their customs and their habits. And it's still difficult. And the road ahead is still going to be difficult. And when we come here to Nehemiah chapters 11 and 12, there's a lot that we're going to cover, but it's going to ask us this question: are we willing to sacrifice? So the whole point of today's message, today's sermon, is that a life surrendered in worship to God is a life marked by willful sacrifice. A life surrendered in worship to God is a life marked by willful sacrifice. Now, you might be asking me the question, okay, Pastor, what do you mean by sacrifice? Well, let me give you a little bit of a definition, a working definition. Sacrifice is really this. It's an act of giving up something valued for the sake of something else regarded more important or worthy. So it's something that we think is valuable, something that we treasure, but we're giving up that thing for something that's more important or more worthy. So when I ask this question, when we not ask this question, but think about this idea that a life surrendered in worship to God is a life marked by willful sacrifice, are we sacrificing for the sake of Jesus? Today, we're tackling these chapters, Nehemiah 11 and 12. And if you're one of those people that get ahead and start to read ahead because you like to read ahead, you like to know what's coming up, you know that there are a lot of verses coming up in Nehemiah chapters 11 and 12. But do not fear. We are going to highlight those passages, those sections in these chapters that really communicate this point. Because we do come across another list of names. I'm not going to tackle that list of names. You've heard me do that before and fail miserably at it. But we are going to just hit some of these highlights in Nehemiah chapter 11 and 12. And as we look at this idea of a surrendered life is marked by one of sacrifice, there's really three areas of sacrifice that I want to talk about today that I think we can clearly pull out in Nehemiah chapters 11 and 12. And the first is this: when it comes to our worship, when it comes to surrendering our lives to Christ, it is marked by a sacrifice of preference. A sacrifice of preference. In Nehemiah chapter 11, first two verses reads this. Now the leaders of the people lived in Jerusalem, and the rest of the people cast lots to bring 1 out of 10 to live in Jerusalem, the holy city, while 9 out of 10 remained in the other towns. And the people blessed all the men who willingly offered to live in Jerusalem. So again, here we are. The walls are built. An amazing feat. Through insurmountable odds, through constant oppression, through constant obstacles and opposition from external enemies and internal doubts and concerns that come up, this amazing feat of rebuilding the wall in 52 days is done. And the people are starting to come together. They're starting to rebuild their worship culture, their society, their identity as the people of God. And here is a question or a statement that the leaders were living in Jerusalem, but they had to cast lots in order for others to follow suit. Like, why? Why are they doing this? Why are they casting lots? And then why were some willingly offering to live in Jerusalem? You have to remember, when we were in Nehemiah's chapter 2 and chapter 4, it wasn't just the walls of Jerusalem that was in ruins. It was really the whole city. I mean, you had heard me mention earlier that there was no economy, there was no education system, there was no real structure, infrastructure for a thriving society. And so they had rebuilt the walls, but all right, now what? Where are we going to live? Like, this is ruins here in Jerusalem. Like, we're going to leave our businesses, we're going to leave our farms, we're going to leave our prosperous way of living and head back into a city that needs to be rebuilt, an education system needs to be built up, an economy that needs to be built up. Like, really, is this what we're doing? Now, when we get to, right off the bat, the first verse of chapter 11, it's interesting that it says, now the leaders of the people lived in Jerusalem. To suggest that the leaders are beginning to lead by example. So they're leaving their cushy lifestyles and they're beginning to go back to the ruins of the city to rebuild and prepare for what is the potential that could take place there in the city. Some people cast lots. Now, this is an interesting concept for us today because we don't really leave things by the roll of the die. But back in the Old Testament, this was actually a way in which the people of God would surrender different decisions to God himself. There's a verse in Proverbs chapter 16 that says, the lot falls on the lap, but the decision belongs to the Lord. So this was actually a practice in which, okay, you wanted to find out the will of God, let's draw some straws, let's go ahead and roll the die, let's cast lots and see where that lot lands. And that was the answer. So they cast lots, but then there were some there who were willingly offering to go leave their lifestyle to help rebuild the city. And then we get into verses 3 of chapter 11 all the way to chapter 12, verse 26, and it's this next long list of names. So I'm going to spare us reading that, but we see this long list of names of people who moved back into the system, to the city. We're used to these lists of names. Chapter 3, we saw the list of names of those people who worked on the wall of Jerusalem. In chapter 7, we saw those people that returned the first time to Jerusalem with Zerubbabel. In chapter 8, it's the list of names involved in the morning to midday worship service. I keep looking at you guys when I say morning to midday over the last couple of weeks. I don't know why. I'm like maybe trying to subconsciously put a little hint in there. Morning to midday worship service. And then chapter 10 that we read last week, those are the people that signed their names committing to following the laws of God, specifically in the areas of restoring the Sabbath, of supporting the temple, that we see these lists of names again in chapters 11 and 12. And why is this important? Well, again, it was a history of the people who were counted in this rebuilding of Jerusalem, but it also shows that people counted in his story, in God's story of redeeming his people to himself. It just reminds us that people matter to God. People matter to God, so much so that God essentially sends his son Jesus to die for them. So let's not get so caught up in the numbers, but to remember that each number represents a person, that people matter to God. But getting back to this whole idea of sacrifice of preference, when people are relocating back into Jerusalem, they're helping to bring life back into the city, and this was really a sacrifice of preference. They were leaving what they built for themselves. They were leaving their comforts and their conveniences to do something better for the good of the people and the glory of God. Now, isn't this a picture of the church today? Or should I say, ought this not be a picture of the church today? That people are willingly offering to put their preferences to the back seat for the betterment of other people far from God. I can remember for Colleen and I, when we went through that decision of leaving the marketplace, leaving our comforts and our conveniences to go full bore into the ministry, trusting God that he was going to provide that we wrestled with that for a while. Like, that wasn't just a decision we came to overnight, that we did some major praying and major, God, are you sure? Like, hesitation stuff where it was really just our lack of trust in God that he was going to provide, that we delayed that step into the ministry because we had preferences. We had built up a nice little life for ourselves. We had the nice house, we had the nice cars, and we were doing pretty good. We were happy. But a life of worship, a life of surrender is always going to be marked by sacrifice, and it begins with a sacrifice of preference. Even to the point where, like, we knew there were going to be privileges that our kids were going to miss out on because of this moving into this calling that God had for us. Are you willing to sacrifice your preferences for the good of other people and the glory of God? Some of you today, you might be feeling that call. You might be feeling that urging. Perhaps you've been wrestling with that for months or years, and you haven't just stepped into that by faith, singing these songs that God is faithful, God is going to provide, he doesn't fail. Are you sacrificing your preferences for a greater purpose, for a higher purpose? And so consider this question. What are you currently doing that is uncomfortable to advance the kingdom of God? What are you currently doing that is sacrificing your preferences, your conveniences to help people meet, know, and follow Jesus? See, it was never just about the walls in the book of Nehemiah. It was all about bringing God's people back, building up their worship and their culture. And it meant that people had to sacrifice their preferences in order to make that happen. What are you willing to sacrifice? You see, the church was never meant to be a community focused on ourselves, but a community focused on others far from God. That is the whole point that we do this thing. That we're here on this earth, that once we become saved, once we place our faith and trust in Jesus, our lives never become about, or are no longer about us, but those who don't yet know him, who don't yet know his love and have experienced his forgiveness, that the church is always about other people, rescuing those far from God. And so are you willing to sacrifice your preferences for God's purposes? To sit in a nursery with a crying baby so that a single mom can sit for an hour in peace and quiet and hear from God. To sacrifice your preference of time and watching football games on Saturday afternoons to come help set up so that hundreds of people can come together and hear from God. Are you willing to sacrifice your preferences? And those are really, really small preferences, might I add. Like, those aren't really big things. Like, let's be honest. Like, let's just toughen up and get better at moving the kingdom of God forward in our immediate areas. That it doesn't, yeah, it's a couple of hours. Are you willing to sacrifice your preferences? Sorry, I'm getting a little heated now. I'm starting to push because I think we need to be pushed. God's church needs to be pushed. And it's not just our church, it's the church in general that it needs to be pushed to, stop worrying about our comforts and our conveniences and sacrificing our preferences for his purpose, to make much of him for the good of people far from him. What are you sacrificing? See, some things are easy to give, but are you willing to go to the extremes for Jesus, who is more important and more worthy than the most valuable thing that we possess? Are you willing to do that? Because a life surrendered in worship to God is a life marked by willful sacrifice. Are you willing to sacrifice your preferences for a higher purpose? This is really all that they're talking about in chapters 11, verse 1 through 12, verse 26. But then we come to this other area of sacrifice. And the second area of sacrifice I want to talk about when it comes to a surrendered life, a life of worship, is marked by sacrifice of praise. Listen to what it says in Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 27. It says, then at the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, they sought the Levites in all their places to bring them to Jerusalem to celebrate the dedication with gladness, with thanksgiving, and with singing, with cymbals, harps, and lyres. Verse 31, then I brought the leaders of Judah up onto the wall and appointed two great choirs that gave thanks. Jump over to verse 40. So both choirs of those who gave thanks stood in the house of God, and I and half of the officials with me. Jump to verse 42. And the singers sang with Jezrehiah as their leader, and they offered great sacrifices that day and rejoiced, for God had made them rejoice with great joy. The women and the children also rejoiced, and the joy of Jerusalem was heard far away. A sacrifice of praise. Now, full disclosure, if you have been with us since the beginning, maybe you were with us in that first year or so, you know that I come from a worship background. So when I read passages like this, it just like gets me going. Like it fuels my heart that there's hope. Like to see that these choirs and the people coming together to worship musically with cymbals, harps, and lyres. I mean, we're talking drums and guitars, pianos. That when these people came together, they worshiped in such a way, they sang in such a way that their joy was heard far away. So here we go. When it comes to a sacrifice of praise, that the people of God were bearing witness to watching what God had done over the last 2-3 months in rebuilding the walls, that God had done a great work, that he is worthy of worship and praise. The enemy has said that the walls were so weak. If you remember a couple chapters back, that a couple of foxes would hop up on those walls and they would fall down. And so what does Nehemiah do? He gets all the people to stand on the walls as they sing to show, no, this is who our God is. This is how good our God is. This is how great our God is. And by the way, it only took 52 days. Like there is this overflow of praise, of sacrificing their preferences, sacrificing their insecurities, sacrificing their selves just to give God honor and praise for all that he had done. Now it's interesting to note that as we read this revival of worship that's starting to happen in Jerusalem, that at no point in the book of Nehemiah does God actually command them to worship. That it's not anything we see that Nehemiah commands the people to worship, that Nehemiah just starts kind of assigning people to do certain things, the Levites, the singers, the musicians, and as they start worshiping, as they start praising, the people follow along, and before long their joy is heard from far away. This is what I think David means in Psalm 103. This is what Todd, you even mentioned just a few minutes ago in Psalm 103, when David says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and everything that is within me, bless his holy name." Why does David say that? Well, he continues on in verse 2, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits. Forget not his goodness, who forgives all of your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles." See, the joy that people heard from far away is because they were blessing the Lord with everything that was inside them. As they reflected on God's goodness, how he forgave their sins, how he healed all their diseases, how they rebuilt the wall, they were blessing the Lord because they couldn't help but bless the Lord with everything that was within them. And then we have this command out of Hebrews chapter 13 that says this: "Through him, through Jesus, then let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name." So let me ask you this question. Are you willingly sacrificing an offering of praise with your lips? Are you offering God a sacrifice of praise even in the midst of problems? Because again, there is still a lot of work to be done in Jerusalem. There were still long days ahead. There were still obstacles to come, but they were praising because they saw what God had already done. They knew what God was going to do in the future. Are you sacrificing praise to God even in the midst of your problems? Do you, even right now, we're going to close this service in a little bit with a song of praise. Are you going to sing that song with everything in you, so much so that your neighbor's windows are going to rattle? Is there going to be so much joy in your life that people far away notice that there's something different about that person? There's something different about that family. See, this is what a life of worship surrendered to Jesus is marked by: these sacrifices of praise. Because when you think about it, for most people, singing is an act of vulnerability. Like, yeah, Emily, Todd, you guys might like to sing. You might enjoy it. But for a lot of people, like that's vulnerable. Like, that's almost exposing your whole entire soul to open your mouth in an act of praise. Are you worshiping God with an act of praise, with your voice? And I hope that as we start to come back together in person after being apart for 7-8 months, that when we come back together and we worship God together, that our voices would be lifted up loud so it literally shakes the windows of the people next door. Is your life marked by sacrifices of praise? A life surrendered in worship to God is a life marked by willful sacrifice. It's a sacrifice of preferences. It's a sacrifice of praise. And then the third one is this, is that a surrendered life is marked by sacrifices of possessions. Listen to what verses 44 through 47 say in Nehemiah chapter 12. It says, "On that day, men were appointed over the storerooms, the contributions, the first fruits, and the tithes, to gather into them the portions required by the law for the priests and for the Levites according to the fields of the towns. For Judah rejoiced over the priests and the Levites who ministered. And they performed the service of their God and the service of purification, as did the singers and the gatekeepers, according to the command of David and his son Solomon. For long ago in the days of David and Asaph, there were directors of the singers, and there were songs of praise and thanksgiving to God. And all Israel in the days of Zerubbabel and in the days of Nehemiah gave the daily portions for the singers and the gatekeepers. And they set apart that which was for the Levites, and the Levites set apart that which was for the sons of Aaron." So last week, if you remember in Nehemiah chapter 10, that that the people had committed to supporting the temple, supporting all the ministry that was going on in the temple. There was various ways in which they were supporting the temple. They supported the temple through temple dues. They supported the temple by supplying wood. If you remember the brazen altar, it was commanded by God that the flame of the brazen altar should always be lit. It should never go out. And with wood being a scarce resource, it was a valuable commodity. So people were giving wood. People were giving their first fruits. So as they harvested their crops, the first and the best of their harvest would go to the temple. And people were even offering their firstborns, dedicating them to the Lord for work in the temple service. And then you had the tithes. And if you remember me saying last week that even the Levites were responsible for tithing from the tithes, that the priests and the ministers with the resources that they were given by the temple, they were giving a tithe from that back to the temple. You know, it's similar for us today here as a church, that for people like me, for people like Pastor Reese, for people like Jen Gatenopoulos, who leads our kids ministry, for people like Amber, who helps Jen lead the kids ministry, for Emily, our administrative assistant, we are supported by those who support the church, who give back to God. For Reese and I, we are the ones who are fully supported by the church, that we are blessed to be in a situation in which we don't have to go out and work other jobs to make ends meet, but we are fully supported by the church, by your giving to the church, so that we can concentrate on the ministry, the building up the church here in Chester County. Now, when it comes to mission, if you've been with us for any length of time, you know that we don't really talk about giving all that much. I mean, we talk about the methods, you know, every time in we start a service, you know, give online, missioncommunity.church/give. You can find out all the options, text to give, blah, 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 blah. We talk about ways to give, but we don't really spend too much time twisting arms that people should give. But one of the things that happens when we do a book study like this, Nehemiah, that we are forced to hit on topics that are in the book. And like last week in chapter 10, I spent time focusing on, okay, what does it look like to give to the temple? And here again in chapter 12, there's this sacrifice of possessions to support the ministry, the temple, if you will, of the church now today. And if I'm honest with you, I hate talking about money. I hate it. Like, I'm not a fundraiser. That is not in my bone. I am not good at it. It is not my natural inclination to do so. But I think we're forced to talk about it for just a moment, because there is sacrifice in this area that is a mark of one who is completely surrendered to Jesus Christ. And I ask myself the question, why? Like, why out of a lot of topics, why is money one of those that kind of rubs people? Why do I feel awkward about it? Why do you feel awkward about listening to me talk about it? Why is that? And might I suggest to us today that really money is that little g God that has its hand around our necks in our culture today? Like, if we're just completely honest, that is the little g God of our culture. We live in one of the wealthiest counties in Pennsylvania, the wealthiest county in Pennsylvania, and one of the wealthiest counties in the country. That we become dependent on it. We have comforts and conveniences because of the living that we can make. And I'm not trying to guilt us into we're so fortunate. I think God has placed us in a time such as this to leverage our resources. But I wonder if we're just a little too dependent on it, if we're a little too desirous of it, if we're too dangerous with it, if we drive ourselves into debt when we don't have what we want. Here are some scriptures to consider when we talk about money. that Jesus is talking to his disciples and to a crowd of people. He's talking about, you know, laying up for yourselves treasures in heaven, that the possessions and the material things that we gain here on the earth, it's all going to pass away. And he says this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. Jesus says, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." Or we can look to the passage in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. It says, "Keep your life free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he said, I will never leave you or forsake you." That is God's presence enough? Is God's presence more important than your possessions? Like, just him being present with you, is that enough? This is what the writer of Hebrews is getting at. If you jump down to 1 Timothy chapter 6, when the apostle Paul is encouraging this young pastor, he says this, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs." That Paul is saying to Timothy, the wrong kind of love will lead you into the wrong kind of worship. That that money isn't evil, and people get this verse out of whack sometimes. They totally mess up the context of this verse. They say money is the root of all evil. No. It says, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil." So there is a deeper issue going on when it comes to our possessions, when it comes to our money. And are we willing to sacrifice our possessions, that which we deem valuable, for something more important and more worthy? See, sacrifice is a sign of a surrendered life to Jesus. Sacrifice hurts. Sacrifice is going to cost us something. It isn't cheap. But the sacrifice of Jesus is cheapened when there's even one thing that we are unwilling to sacrifice for him. Let me say that again, that the sacrifice of Jesus, what he did for us on the cross, it is cheapened when there is even one thing that we are unwilling to sacrifice for him. Because Jesus sacrificed everything. For you, for me, for his people, the church, his bride. He sacrificed everything. He left the riches of heaven for the ruins of this earth. This is what it says in Philippians chapter 2. That we, as followers of Jesus, that we must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. That though he was God, he did not think equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. As followers of Jesus, we model Jesus' life of sacrifice. And this is what we see in these chapters of Nehemiah, that the people sacrificed their preferences. They left their cushy lifestyles to go into the city, into the ruins, to help rebuild it. There was a lot of rebuilding to be done. There was lots of crime there happening in Jerusalem. Do you remember when they were rebuilding the walls? They had a tool in one hand and a weapon in the other. So it wasn't easy, but they sacrificed their preferences. And as they sacrificed their preferences and they saw God do amazing things, then they sacrificed with praise. They lifted up his great name through song and through worship, so much so that their joy could be heard from far away, and then they sacrificed their possessions. They gave to support the worship of the church. They gave to support the ministers of the temple. And again, here back in those verses, it again says that the Levites gave to support the priests, the sons of Aaron. So you may feel as though I'm preaching at you today. I am preaching at myself. That I am not, set aside this is for all of the people of God. That a surrendered life is one that is marked by sacrifice. But here's the thing that we can look forward to. When we sacrifice, when we give everything that we have for Him, that it's in our sacrifice that we find true, ultimate, everlasting joy. It is in our sacrifice that we get to experience the joy of Christ. Listen to what it says in Hebrews chapter 12. It says, let us run then with endurance. Let us run with endurance this race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross. That for the sacrifice that was set before Him, He sacrificed everything, despising the shame, and seated at the right hand of the throne of God. It was for the joy set before Him, He endured the sacrifice on the cross. You see, when we look at Jerusalem's joy, it wasn't a reaction to God's command. No, it was a response to God's covenant with them. That I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. I will always be faithful to you. I will always love you. There is forgiveness. It is your choice whether or not to accept it. And when we get a realization of just how much God loves us and how much God did for us and how much He has forgiven us through His Son, Jesus, we shouldn't be able to hold in our praise. We shouldn't be able to live in our preferences, but to hand everything over to Him. We shouldn't be able to grip onto things so tightly, but to release them for God to use as He sees fit for a greater purpose, for a greater calling. That we have a lot of people today, a lot of Christians in the church that experience temporary joy. You know, we go experience that new house we just bought until we get that first mortgage payment. We experience that nice new car that we just got for 2 months before that lease agreement comes on our door. That we find temporary joy in things, but we're missing out on the ultimate everlasting joy. That few Christians experience this eternal joy, the joy of knowing that you are forgiven and that you are loved. So that no matter what's going on around you, you can rest secured in the love of God. That there's so much more coming in the future. That the inheritances of heaven are coming your way. Our surrender to Jesus and our sacrificing for Him ultimately comes down to a matter of the will. Are we willing to offer everything to Him? To sacrifice our preferences, to offer up sacrifices of praise, to sacrifice our possessions so that His kingdom can continue to spread here on this earth with the days that we have left for a higher purpose. What is Jesus asking you to sacrifice today? It might be you've been part of our church for a couple years now and you've never given to support the church. The ministry of the church. Maybe He's calling you to sacrifice your possessions today. Maybe He's calling you to sacrifice your preferences, that as we start gathering here in a couple of weeks, we're going to be learning things along the way in this COVID season, in this pandemic season, and there's going to be people that we need to help come alongside us so that we can serve one another, to watch kids, to help people find their way, that there's going to be people that we're going to rely on that's going to have to help teach others in their new faith, because we're going to have to change ministry here. We're not always going to be able to gather in large crowds. What is God calling you to sacrifice for the betterment, for the building up of His church? Is Jesus everything in your life? Is He everything? And if you had nothing else than Jesus, would He be enough? a life of sacrifice. I believe we have a lot of improvement in this area that we can work on, me included, all of us. It was funny, Todd, you and I were talking a couple weeks ago, and we were just asking a question, why is it so easy for us to spend money on ourselves, to do things that we like to do when we could use those resources, we could use our time to bless other people? Like, I was thinking of this with Colleen, like our cable bill. We pay like $200 a month for cable. I don't even like watching cable right now. There's nothing but just division on TV right now. But it's so easy for us to spend $200 a month on cable when what if we used that $200 and gave it back to the church? What if we used that $200 and helped pour it into some local nonprofit here in the area that's doing something significant? I promise that if we would sacrifice more things, I think we would experience greater joy. Because I have yet to experience any act of sacrifice that I wasn't just eternally joyful and grateful for. That I was able to praise God immediately following. What is Jesus asking you to sacrifice today? Because as followers of Jesus here at Mission Community Church, with this mission of helping people meet, know, and follow Jesus, we don't know how much time's left. And there are people far from God that need to know about his love and his forgiveness. So let's be a people surrendered to Jesus, marked by lives of sacrifice. Heavenly Father, you need to do a work. Holy Spirit, you need to work in our hearts, in our minds. You need to work in our individual lives. You need to work in our families. You need to work in our church here in Chester County. You need to work in your church. And so would you move, would you breathe, would you reveal those areas in our lives that we are clinging to too tightly? Give us the courage to loosen our grip, to surrender those things to you, to sacrifice those things for a greater purpose, ultimately for your glory and the good of other people. And may we build our lives of worship from that place, knowing that you sacrificed everything for us. And what a realization of that truth, just overflow in thanksgiving and gratitude and joyful praise of your great name. In Jesus' name.